Tonight, a closer look at a familiar sight. It's the Citgo sign in Boston. And while it might be something you see every day, you've probably never seen it like this. Tonight, John Doherty goes to the top for a look at part of the skyline that got Boston written all over it.
It is indeed a landmark for Boston. The colors, red, white, and blue, are indeed pop art, American neon. The cycling is almost hypnotic. You're pulled in almost like a heartbeat to the sign. The more you watch it, the more you want to see it.
Atop the BU Bookstore Mall in Kenmore Square, the Citgo sign, with its bright colors and mesmerizing patterns. It can be seen for 30 miles.
It becomes a mid-20th century icon of American commercial art.
Arthur Krim is with the Society for Commercial Archaeology, a group concerned with preserving the roadside heritage of 20th century America.
It's the last of probably eight or so large Citgo signs that were built in the 1960s. It's the last one surviving of a giant neon spectacular.
It started out as a green and white city service sign back in 1940, but in 1965, it was time to modernize. The company changed its name, its logo, and the sign. The red delta stands for company founder Henry L. Doherty. Everything with the sign went along just fine until the 1970s oil crisis. Citgo turned it off as an example of saving energy. By 1982, the sign was in disrepair, and Citgo decided it was time for the sign to go. As workers started to take it apart, the public rallied. There was enormous outcry to save the sign, and a court order halted the demolition. Was it a landmark? There was a hearing, and the city said no. It wasn't even 50 years old. But Citgo changed its corporate mind anyway and spared the sign. It was reconditioned at a cost of $300,000, and in August 1983, as thousands of fans at Fenway Park watched, the sign was relit.
As large American neon signs go, it really is one of the great North American monuments of its type. There are very few that survive from this mid-20th century period.
Hold on. Martin Foley has been maintaining the Citgo sign for 27 years.
I replace the neon as it's needed. Face the burnt GTO, high-tension wire, transformers. We got a flashing mechanism, the contact, keep the flashes in sync.
Here are the stats. The sign is 60 by 60 feet. At its highest point, 200 feet off the ground. There are 5 miles of neon tubing, 20 miles of electrical wire, and 150 transformers. Martin spends about 40 hours a month dangling on the face of the sign, changing broken neon tubes. Is he concerned with being shocked?
The amperage is very low. It's a milliamp. Not enough to kill me unless it knocks me out of the chair, and then I'm done.
It's the wind, snow, ice, and old age that break the neon tubes. And as for the electrician, does he ever slip and take a few out?
That's a very high question to answer on camera. Very seldom.
Want me to turn it on?
Yes, go ahead.
So the Citgo sign remains a beacon over Kenmore Square. Is it a landmark? For some, there's no question.
Indeed, it's both national as well as a heritage within Boston's own heritage of history, from the Paul Revere House to Quincy Market, and now we have the Citgo sign.
For the 7:30 Report, I'm John Doherty.
The people at Citgo headquarters in Tulsa, Oklahoma, tell us that it costs them about $300,000 a year to keep that sign going, from the electricity to the upkeep. We understand they're planning to paint it next year. Monday night.